Okay, I am joined at 24 minutes past two on a Sunday afternoon by my studio guest for this afternoon, and his name is Kevin Lear. Kevin, good afternoon, and welcome to Lake District Radio.
Hello.
Now then, you have got a story to tell, but... Oh, yes. As you said just now, we could do a series, actually.
Introduce
yourself and tell us a bit about who you are and what you do.
Well, Kevin Lear. I am the owner of Motorbike TV, Motorbike Adventures of Britain, Motorbike Adventures of wherever you would like me to go. Been doing it now for 10 years. Prior to that, I used to run a business. Prior to that, I was in the forces. Prior to that, I was a policeman. And it's been a journey ever since I turned the wonderful age of 17.
Absolutely. Right. Now then, tell me, which branch of the forces were you in?
I was in the Royal Electrical and Mechanical Engineers.
Right, okay.
I served for 9 years. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, I had to leave because I damaged my back.
Right.
Which broke my heart.
Yeah.
It was my family. I didn't want to leave. And mm-hmm. of course, very poignant with today, that there I was watching the TV down at the Cenotaph, and very proud I was of all of them as well.
Yes, indeed, yes. Did you see the service on the television last night?
No, unfortunately I didn't.
Oh, no. Right, no. It's always done very well, but it seemed to be even better this year. I don't know why, but it was absolutely... It's always moving, always poignant. And I was thinking about my dear old dad this morning. I think about him a lot, but especially on days like this, because he served in the Royal Navy during the Second World War. And never used to talk about it.
No, they never do.
No, they don't. No. The only thing that he did say to me once, and there's only once, when he had a few sherbets, was he said to me, "If you think that the Germans were cruel and wicked, you should have seen what the Japs did."
Well, my step grandfather,
yeah,
who lived in Ripon,
yeah,
I remember him as George Hornby. He was captured by the Japanese,
right?
And I wasn't around him that much, but my step brother and sister, they tried to get him to talk, and he just wouldn't.
No.
There was just no conversation. No. Nobody found out anything at all.
Mm. No. We can't even in these days when mental health awareness is so much bigger than it used to be, you just can't imagine the horrors they went through.
Yeah.
And the worst thing of all is that they obviously didn't have anywhere or anybody really to turn to. So, and obviously something that affected them for the rest of their lives, and it's just horrific on so many levels. But... that said, let's move on to something a little bit more cheerful, shall we?
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. So you came out of the forces.
Yes.
And did you go straight into the police after that?
No, it was the police and then the forces.
I beg your pardon.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
So the police came first.
Yeah. When I came out of the forces, kind of fell into the tourism world, if you will.
Right.
Bounced around from job to job, which an awful lot of ex-forces do.
Yeah.
Went for every interview. Oh, you're a strapping lad. Yes, we'll give you a job.
Yeah.
And then I had an opportunity of setting up my own businesses because I'd been working in tourism and exploring Britain started.
Right, I see.
And built that business up to around about 40 people.
Yeah.
Then had somewhat of a disaster in the middle thousands. Went away for a while and came back again.
Mm-hmm.
And... had a serious operation in 2000, which saved my life.
Right.
And then in 2001, started again.
Mm.
Motorbike TV.
Yeah.
Its roots started in 2009.
Right. Now, I know you mentioned Motorbike TV. Mm. You also mentioned, Motorbike Adventures of India.
Mm.
And Motorbike, of course, Motorbike Tours of Cumbria.
Yes.
There's lots of things going on.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Motorbike TV is 10 years old.
Yes.
What was the first thing you did with regard to that particular project?
Well, it might sound somewhat strange, but if I remember rightly, in the August of 2009, I sacked everybody.
Right.
There was around about 15 people, and I heard something that was going on in the background, and I thought, I've had enough of this. So I sacked them all. I got on my bike and rode across to Hawkshead. And you know the road between Hawkshead and Windermere where the ferry goes?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I was parked there looking back towards Hawkshead, looking over the water. And I went, Motorbike TV. Because prior to that, I'd been making films online, and I think I was the first person to put films online. And before we'd even heard of YouTube. And all of a sudden, I thought, hang on a minute. I could do this myself. Technology had made cameras smaller.
Yeah.
So I came back from there and went on eBay and looked at cameras. And I found a camera by a company called Drift.
Mm-hmm.
That in itself cost me £75. But you could put a little microphone in the back of it and put it into your helmet and start talking about stuff.
Right.
And I just went around and filmed and talked about the stuff that I'd discovered over the years of working around this area.
Yeah.
And went to see people and said, what do you think? Ooh, yes, we'll have some of that. Ooh, we want to be part of that. Oh, yeah, this is fantastic. And I decided also that it would be better just to stay on my own.
Yeah.
Because I needed to control it all. I needed to be able to make sure that the films were going to be okay. And that's how we started.
Excellent. Right. Well, we'll be talking more about that in a few minutes' time. But first of all, we're going to have a break for a bit of music, then catch up and see what's happening on the roads. It's Lake District Radio on a Sunday afternoon. I'm Steve Guppy. My studio guest is Kevin Lear. Back with him after we have heard from Johnny Maestro and the Quests. And this is called I'm Stepping Out of the Picture. Oh, Man U 2-0 up. Ben Olding, birthday and Christmas all at once. Make the most of it, Ben. It won't happen again.
Stepping out of the picture. I'm stepping out of the picture. Stepping out of the picture. I'm stepping out of the picture. Tony comes to me when you have no one else. Never have you ever loved me for myself. I've had enough. You keep me hanging. Out of the picture. I'm stepping out of the picture. Though you have been fooled for such a long, long time, now I'm gonna find someone who'll be alive. Baby, goodbye.
Classic bit of Northern Soul there for you on Lake District Radio. That's Johnny Maestro and the Quests. And I'm stepping out of the picture. The time is 27 and a half minutes towards the hour of 3 o'clock.
Oh, yeah, if you're traveling by car, either in or out of the city, ooh, here's the latest edition of the condition of the roads in this vicinity.
Okay, let's have a look and see what's happening. The A6 Shap Road in Kendal is slow traffic. Our Beth's favourite, the A6 Lancaster one-way system, is slow traffic with a time delay of 4 minutes. The A6 Lancaster Road in Carnforth is very slow traffic. A590, that's County Road in Ulverston, is slow traffic. Yes, I hope that stretch is open again tonight. I've had to go the long way round to Kendal the last two nights. The A591, let me just have a look and see what's happening on that one, as he says, trying to grab the mouse. Here we go. Yeah, the A591 Kendal bypass is busy but moving with a time delay of 4 minutes. It's a usual congestion on the A6 Highgate in Kendal, and that's about it. So whatever you do, please remember to take care, and above all, stay safe on the roads.
Guppy Show on Lake District Radio. Don't say we didn't warn you.
That's an all-time classic. Now, come on, you've got to be of an age, but I'm sure that most of you know that. The wonderful Hancock's Half Hour, which started on the BBC. Oh, 10 quid in the swear box. Started on the BBC in 1954. And what a wonderful, stellar cast it was. Hancock, Sir James, Bill Kerr, Hattie Jakes and Kenneth Williams. Written by Galton and Simpson, of course. Who also wrote Steptoe and Son. Incidentally, here's one for you to think about. What's the connection between Elton John and Steptoe and Son? I'll tell you a bit later. And there is a genuine connection there as well. Right, I'm talking to Kevin Lear. Kevin Lear, who runs, apart from other things, Motorbike TV. And we were just talking before the break, Kevin, about how you actually started Motorbike TV. And it's been running for 10 years, is that right?
Yeah, just over 10 years.
Yeah, right, okay. And obviously you're very connected with all things tourism.
I've met a few people in my time.
Yeah.
I was in the tourism world prior to setting up Motorbike TV, so
yeah.
There was quite a few people that I know.
Yeah. Now, you have a new film.
Mm.
It's called Cumbria by Motorbike.
It is indeed.
So it's one of those, does what it says on the tin. Now, I've seen the trailer. It's absolutely captivating. Tell me something, it really is. Tell me something about the film.
Well, this was the first area that I ever worked when I came into tourism. And I think that would be somewhere in the region of early 90s, because I came out the army in 88.
Yeah.
Now being the wrong side of 60, of course, it makes me think, my God, that's a long time ago. but this was the first area, and I just fell in love with it and kept coming back and coming back. And so the first film that I ever did for Motorbike TV was Cumbria.
Right.
And I've done it in various guises over the years. Spread my wings into further fields within the UK and abroad. But I've always wanted to produce a feature film.
Yes.
And that goes back to being in the army, because I was a recruit instructor.
Right.
And there was a guy called Mike who used to run after us with a whacking great camera on his shoulder, running after us and standing still and filming us. And
yeah.
The recruits would buy them when they passed out and, oh, look at me, Mum, what have I been doing? And when I looked at that, I thought, my God, you're captured in that time of your life forever. So you'll forever be, for example, 20-year-old.
Yeah.
And that stuck in my mind. So when I'd been doing the filming side under Tourism TV, and then Motorbike TV came along, it just had to be this area. But it also then had to go deeper. I wanted to produce something instead of little clips that most guys do with bikes. Everybody's got a head cam now. And they ride along, and some are good and some are not so good.
Yeah.
but I wanted to go and produce something that I could be proud of, that also would be played on the cinema.
Yeah.
I can't remember when I didn't want to have a film I could do to be shown in the cinema. And somebody popped up early this year and went, I know. I went, oh, do you? Mm. And spoke to them and they went, yeah. We know your work and yeah.
Yeah.
So I said, right, well, play me something of my stuff and I'll come down and have a look and see if it's good enough. And that's where the seed was sown to go back round with the modern mini cameras or action cameras, however you want to call them.
Yeah.
But also to have my brother on his bike filming me from a different perspective, but not to have any advertisers in.
Mm-hmm.
There's a reason behind that as well, mine, but that's another story altogether.
Okay.
There's a sponsor. Yes, there is a sponsor, and that's Held Rider Equipment that sponsored me for the last 7 years with my gear. And so it was a case of you have to wait for the right weather.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I did.
Right. Fair enough.
What I've produced now is also live on Amazon Prime.
Yeah.
And the reviews are not too bad.
Right, excellent, says he modestly. They're excellent, as indeed they should be. Now, Kevin said about a film on the cinema screen, and this film is going to be where?
It's going to be shown for one night only in the Roxy at Ulverston on the 8th of December.
And there's also going to be another showing somewhere else.
Yes, it'll be up at the Royalty in Bowness, but that'll be next year.
That'll be next year, yeah. Right, okay. So give us that date once again then for Ulverston.
It's the 8th of December
right.
at 4:15.
Okay.
It'll only be a couple of hours.
Yeah.
Because the film itself is just short of 50 minutes long for Cumbrian by motorbike.
Right.
But there's going to be a little surprise at the beginning of it as an intro.
Right, okay.
And nobody's going to know about that.
No, and if you want to know, you'll have to go. If people are interested and want to come along, what do they need to do?
They can go online and type in cumbriabymotorbike.co.uk.
Right, and you'll find all the information. I've already been on the website, folks. It's well worth a visit, I tell you. Right, we are talking to Kevin Lear. It's 2:40, and this is the wonderful Diana Dawes. From the 1960 album, brilliant title, Swinging Doors.
Got a good mind to quit. I've taken all I can. It's time to get up and get and move right. to another job or maybe another town. The gentleman burns me up. The gentleman gets me down. The gentleman is a dope, a man of many faults. Okay. A clumsy Joe who wouldn't know a rumba from a waltz. The gentleman is a dope and not my cup of tea. Why do I get in a dither? He doesn't belong to me. The gentleman isn't bright. He doesn't know the score. A cake will come, he'll take a crumb and never ask for more. The gentleman's eyes are blue, but little do they see. Why am I beating my brains out? He doesn't belong to me. He's somebody else's problem. She's welcome to the guy. She'll never understand him half as well. Gentleman is a dope. He isn't very smart. He's just a lug you'd like to hug and hold against your heart. The gentleman doesn't know how happy he could be. Look at me crying my eyes out as if he belonged to me. He'll never belong to me. Isn't bright, he doesn't know the score. A cake will come, he'll take a crumb and never ask for more. The gentleman's eyes are blue, but little do they see. Why am I beating my brains out? He doesn't belong to me. He's somebody else's problem. She's welcome to the guy. She'll never understand him half as well as I. The gentleman is a dope. He isn't very smart. He's just a lug you'd like to hug and hold against your heart. The gentleman doesn't know how happy he could be. Look at me crying my eyes out as if he belonged to me.
Ah, oh, there you are. That was the wonderful Diana Dawes, and the gentleman is a dope. One gentleman who is far from being a dope is my studio guest this afternoon. His name is Kevin Lear. He runs, among other things, Motorbike TV, and we've just been talking about the new film that he's got coming out called Cumbria by Motorbike, which is going to premiere at the Roxy in Ulverston on the 8th of December at 4:15. Right, I will write that down. And I tell you what I will do. Now, what I'll do actually, Kevin, later on this afternoon, is I will make sure that I prepare a studio readout so all our presenters will keep on mentioning it
thank
and
you.
Plugging it. Right. Now then, you said that... you said that you've got a sponsor for the film and they're called Held Rider Equipment.
Yes.
Right,
yes.
Okay. So what do they do?
They produce the suits, all apparel, such as leather, one-piece suits, two-piece suits, textiles, boots, gloves, helmets, everything you could possibly want to fit onto your motorbike.
Right.
They started, they're an Austrian company.
Yeah.
And the chap over here is called Guy. He looks after the agency for the UK. And approximately 7 years ago, I went down because I needed some new trousers.
Right.
And it was to a company called Get Geared in Leeds. And we sorted stuff out, and I just happened to find out his name, and I went, do you think he might be interested? And the answer I got was, he might be.
Yeah.
And the next thing I knew, I was going back down to Get Geared to be kitted out in the top-of-the-range suit. And it's continued from there.
Yeah.
Currently, I'm wearing the top-of-the-range suit as well, called the Atacama suit.
The Atacama suit?
The Atacama
right,
suit.
Okay.
In my opinion, and it's not just because of the Held connection, but in my opinion, it's a tremendous set of equipment. You feel so safe in it. But that is the connection with Held. And he's also sponsored me by going across to India.
Yeah.
I've been three times.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, we got on really well.
Mm. And you've also done films in among other places, Cyprus and Tenerife. I believe.
A couple of years ago, was it? Not beginning of this year, beginning of last year.
Right.
Somebody popped up and went, do you fancy coming to Tenerife? I'll get a motorbike and we'll zoom about.
Yeah.
Oh, go on then, I said.
Yeah, force yourself.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So I landed and the guy picked me up and we went to his apartment and the next morning he got up and said, right, I'll take you down and I'll show you your bike. So we went down into the garages below the apartments and there was this scooter.
Yeah.
And I went, no, that can't be it. He went, there it is. I went, well, where? He said, that's it there. And it was this scooter. And oh my God, I was ready to get on the plane and come back. But it was a Kymco and it was a 550cc. And we shot off around Tenerife for 10 days. And I have never had so much fun tearing around an area or an island, should we say, with scenery that would just absolutely knock your socks off. I was waiting for dinosaurs to come out of the countryside.
Right.
And the food, we went, because he lives over there.
Yeah.
We went into some of the traditional cafes that just, again, off the scale.
Mm-hmm.
Cyprus was a different story. I went to Cyprus in March 81 with the army.
Right.
And it was all, oh, Cyprus is fantastic. It's super smashing great and it's the island of love, and I'd always held a bit of a soft spot in my heart for it. So beginning of this year, again, I managed to find a company that would supply me a bike for 10 days, and off I went. But I went in February, and they'd had the worst winter in living memory, and it was still hanging on. In itself, that produced a problem because I was only able to get on the bike for maybe 5 days out of the 10 because the weather was just so bad.
Mm.
But one of the films I was doing, I needed to find this beach which had a cafe on because that's where we were all having fun on a night. And off we went. And I went. And as I was travelling down the road, I saw the sign, Kyrenia Beach Bar. And it was, oh my God, that's it. I'm sure that's it. So I turned right and disappeared onto this beach. And there was the beach hut. And all of a sudden, from being the age of 20, 21, I was 60, and 40 years just disappeared. That it was like being in a bit of a time machine.
Yeah.
I could possibly see myself. There I was, stood next to myself, 40 years apart. And I became rather emotional about it. I should have been really happy because, my God, I'm still alive 40 years later. Whereas all of a sudden I was, oh my God, where's those 40 years gone? And it affected me that much. I became tremendously emotional that night and I brought my flight forward and left Cyprus.
Mm.
It was a strange, very strange experience. But the other part is I do love going to these areas and finding things out that I can get on my bike and film and show people as well.
Absolutely, yeah. Now, you mentioned India that you've been three times. The last time was 4 years ago, but you're going back in January, possibly for about 3 months or so. Is that right?
Yeah, well, it was 3 years ago I went. I went in, well, right, 4 years ago I first went.
Yeah.
In December 15, I then went in March 16 and then November 16.
Right.
The first time I went there in December 15, I still don't know why I went. Because everything in my body was saying, don't go, you'll end up on the TV with your throat being cut and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
And when I got there, I recall standing outside of the office door thinking, what am I doing here? Anyhow, I went in, met some people, everything was hunky-dory, and it changed my life forever.
Right.
I was invited back again in March 16. That was going around a place called Rajasthan. It's the desert. If you look on a map and you see Delhi,
yeah.
Look south, you see Jaipur. To the left of that, or should we say to the west of that, that's the Thar Desert or the Rajasthan area.
Yeah.
They asked me to go back in the March and up to the Assam, which is just outside of Bangladesh, right up in the northeast area. Totally different surroundings, countryside and feel altogether. But I injured myself.
Oh, what happened?
The reason I left the army was because of an injured back.
Yes.
I'd picked up a guy on a run and it had squashed my spine and I had sciatica.
Right.
And it had worn off, but it came back.
Mm-hmm.
And the first day I flew up to Dibrugarh, which is the airport you fly into up there.
Yeah.
And we got on the bikes and when I came out, I thought, well, that's the bike for my right foot. Where's the one for my left? Because it was just this small, rickety Royal Enfield thing. And I just went, oh, my God. Got on it and we rode for 6 hours. We had to and we had to keep going because if we started to ride at night, it's just too dangerous. So yeah. We had to keep going. Got there, told right, go and freshen up and we'll eat. Got on into the shower, got on my bed, had a lie down, tried to get up and couldn't. My whole back had just frozen solid and the pain was off the scale. Mm-hmm. Anyhow, 3 days later, I wasn't exactly casivacked out, but I just knew I couldn't continue on this bike. Going up into the lower Himalayas is where I was going to go. I then went back in November 16 and it was all sorted. I had sponsors, I had Triumph had given me a bike for the period that I was there. The route was sorted, I had a guide, everything was sorted and I got there and they had what was called demonetization.
Demonetization?
They have the rupee.
Right.
And they had the what was it? The 500 rupee and the 1,000 rupee note. And I came into the hotel and it was on the screen saying, as of midnight tonight, this denomination will cease to be legal tender. And
right.
I looked at it and went, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
Got up the next morning, the country ground to a halt. Banks had shut because everybody was just wanting to pour into them. Post offices were shut. You couldn't buy anything. Luckily, I had some Indian friends who went and got me some rupees because they could only change them themselves. I was on the BBC, on the TV, talking about this, and they said, well, why didn't you go and change the money in the queue? I said, it wasn't my place to stand in the queue with the Indians. You know, I'm the white man,
yeah,
and I'm going to be feeling somewhat, you know, awkward. And so I think it was about a week after that, and I just went, I just can't do it. I had the equivalent of £1,000 of notes in my pocket, which was 85,000 rupees, which were just worthless.
Mm.
Absolutely worthless. Luckily, I managed to get it sorted before I left, but yeah, I had to come away. It was, the country just imploded. And people were killing themselves.
Oh, really?
Some of the older generation were literally just having heart attacks in the queues, or they were killing themselves, and they were having carts of money that they were setting fire to. Because it was worthless. And really what it was the black market. But it wasn't the black market. What it was in the fields, the farmers trade cash between themselves. They don't go via the bank.
No.
And the government was saying, but you're not paying tax on that, and we want that tax.
Mm.
And they had money stuffed behind walls and all the rest of the stuff. And so they were taking them out and going, oh my God, what do I do now? And the government's idea was for people to put the money into the bank. Then the government were going to go, how have you got this much without paying tax?
Mm.
And, the country just, it took well over a year before it settled down. But here I am again, plans afoot. Everything is sorted to go back in January for, well, shall we say, up to 3 months, although I've already had the question, why are you going back so soon? In other words, coming back here so soon.
Yes, indeed.
And it's a damn fine question because I nearly went to live there last year.
Right, okay. Right.
I love the place.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's nuts. It's dirty. It's dusty. It's noisy. It's got all the bugs in the world. And it's fabulous.
I've seen lots of different films about India, and it's somewhere that I hope to go one day. I really do.
Change your life.
Because it really does fascinate
it will, honestly.
On many different levels, I have to admit. Right, so anyway, there is a book that Kevin wrote called Touring Rajasthan by Motorbike, and that's available through Amazon if you're interested. And I've got a copy of it here in my hot little mitt, and I shall enjoy having a look through that. I really will.
If you just put Kevin Lear, L-E-A-R, into Amazon, you find all my books.
Well, there you are. Couldn't be simpler. Right, we'll come back for a bit more chat, but we're heading towards the top of the hour with the one and only Dusty. Classic bit of Northern Soul for you. This is called Live It Up. And that was the marvellous Dusty Springfield from 1965, and the one called Live It Up.
You all right, mate?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Yeah? Mm, really? Just, there's a massive grizzly bear sitting on you. You sure you're okay?
Well, now that you mention it, sometimes we say we're fine when we're not. But with one in four experiencing a mental health problem, if your mate says he's fine, he might not be. Be in your mate's corner and ask twice. Time to change.
As a bride on your special day, wouldn't you like to relive those wonderful moments you miss at the push of a button? Clear Image Productions will capture the vows, speeches and the first dance, plus all those once-in-a-lifetime moments shared by family and friends with a professionally produced video unrivaled by photography. Call Clear Image Productions on 07974 645 882.
Yes, to you, everyone. This is Lake District Radio for a Sunday afternoon. It is Remembrance Sunday. It's the 10th of November. It's coming up to 3 o'clock. My name is Steve Guppy, and I'm with you through until 5. We are the biggest, fastest-growing independent radio station in the UK. Thank you very much indeed for all your support.
For the music you won't hear anywhere else, on Real Local Radio, Steve Guppy is on Lake District Radio.
What's up, Doc?
Stand by for action.
Wherever you go,
into the news. You can swing with the blues on this wonderful, wonderful station. Just take a lively companion wherever you go. Take a portable radio. Take a portable radio.
Time to talk about sports.
Please lower your IQ.
Well, it's half-time in the Premiership this afternoon. Manchester United 2, Brighton and Hove Albion 0. Wolverhampton Wanderers 1, Aston Villa 0. And the big one, 4:30 this afternoon, is Liverpool against Manchester City. I'm a little bit hacked off because the first round FA Cup match yesterday between the mighty Yeovil Town 0 and Hartlepool United was called off due to a waterlogged pitch. That's going to be replayed on Tuesday. So I should be all right, misery guts on Wednesday morning, probably, when I come in for the breakfast show and find that we've lost. Other sports are available. And other teams are available as well. And in Yeovil Town's case, it's probably just as well. Actually, they're flying high at the moment. They're second in the National League, only a point off of the top. Right, well, my studio guest this afternoon is Kevin Lear from Motorbike TV, among other things. And you originate from the Northeast, but the thing that attracted you to Cumbria most of all was the lakes. I've got a wonderful quote from you. You say, "The lakes is one of the reasons I moved to Cumbria. I haven't got tired of it. There's bits of road I've been on so many times, I've worn a groove in them." And I really, really love that quote. What fascinates you so much about the lakes?
It doesn't matter what the weather is.
Yeah.
It can be knee-deep in snow.
Yeah.
It can be bathed in glorious blue sky sunshine. It can be blowing a gale. It can be devastating, such as Storm Desmond of 15.
Yeah.
It's still got such an atmosphere. How can you not like it?
Exactly, yeah. Well, as I said to you off mic just now, this is the place where I felt most welcome. Mm. It's, you know, of all the places I've lived, the further I've moved north, strangely enough, the better I felt.
Yeah,
and
absolutely.
It's absolutely wonderful.
Yeah. I mean, when I go around and speak to people, but I go and say, "I'm doing this and doing that. What do you think? Would you like to be involved in all the rest of the stuff?" There's just a warmth. There's a, "Oh, you're going to help us." You would think, wrongly, I now believe that everybody knows Cumbria and the Lake District.
Mm.
They don't.
No, they don't.
The most frequently asked question when people turn up here, where can we go?
Yeah.
And I think, you've travelled all this way, you've done no research, but they've turned up to a hotel or a B&B or a campsite or wherever, and they ask the people behind the desk, "Right, what can we go and see?"
Yeah.
And that is one of the reasons why I started producing films, is to say, well, look, you can go here and go there. And it's one of the reasons also I started to produce Motorbike TV, is bikers don't know where to go. They'll go to a marketplace and they'll sit round a cross, or they'll go to a bridge, whose name will not be mentioned, the very devil of it all. and they'll sit there and talk, and then they'll go home.
Yeah.
Go and have a look. Come round. Okay, it's not for everybody. I think that's one of the reasons Cumbria Tourism are not really enamoured with my film, because they expect us to be tearing around, which is just totally untrue, although there are some people that will.
Yeah, I was reading that in the notes, actually, that you said that you didn't get any response from Cumbria Tourism or from Visit Keswick either. I know you said you'd worked with Visit Eden before.
Yeah.
But yeah, it seems they do seem to have this sort of like this fixed idea in their mind that it's a load of middle-aged hooligans just zooming around, tearing everything up and just making a nuisance of themselves and ruining everybody else's fun. And that couldn't be further from the truth.
Most of us on bikes are of a certain age and more.
Well,
we're
yes.
the only ones who can afford them.
There's nothing wrong with being of a certain age, I can tell
Absolutely,
you that.
Absolutely, yeah.
Because I'm
yeah.
of a certain age myself. And it's getting more certain as the days
yeah,
go by, I can tell you.
Yeah, about it. Yeah. but when I'm, I'd been here about a year, and I went to speak with Eden Tourism, Eden Valley Tourism at Penrith.
Yeah.
And said, look, I'd like to work with you, make some films and everything. And they sponsored it. They gave me some financial support and went, well, I'll do this and this and this. And they worked with me. And a couple of months after I produced it, they fed back to me and said, we've never seen so many motorbikes in our area. And they thought it was fantastic. Keswick, I've heard, and it's only hearsay, I haven't been in the meetings, are of a different opinion. They believe that we will be tearing around, peeing behind every wall, wheeling everywhere and frightening the natives.
Yeah.
Personally, I've never done a wheelie because it scares the living daylights out of me trying to do it. But Cumbria Tourism, they did reply eventually and said that their efforts are on sustainable transport for everybody to come into Cumbria via rail or bus and to use the public transport going around. And with motorbikes, you are not our target market whatsoever. And I felt quite sad about that because the film I've done, yes, I'm on a motorbike, but it's looking at the countryside, it's telling you stories, it's giving you information, it's encouraging you to come and explore this fabulous part of the world. It's not saying, look how fast my bike can go up Rhino's Pass.
Mm.
And I think they've missed a trick, but that's their decision, not mine.
Well, yes, it is, and I agree with you. I think they have missed a trick. Now, something that you said just now is that a lot of people don't know what to do and where to go when they come to the lakes. Mm. And in my experience, a lot of people who come from who live a certain distance away, a lot of them don't actually even really know where the Lake District is.
No.
When we made the decision to move up here, up north, we were living just north of Bristol at the time, and people said to us, oh, where are you going? And we said, where's that?
Yeah.
Was the usual, or why? Why would you want to go there?
Yeah,
lovely living in Bristol. No, it isn't. In fact, I wouldn't even wish that on my worst enemy.
Absolutely.
Living in Bristol. It's horrible
on
so many levels. But hey, I mean, you know, if they don't want to broaden their minds and actually sort of come to a place like this, an area like this, and have real life-changing and life-enhancing experiences, I'm afraid there's not very much we can do about that.
Well, there isn't. There's nothing we can do. We can only give them the opportunity of seeing it.
That's right. Some people's minds are forever going to remain closed, I'm afraid.
Correct.
And anyway, but it's just as well that there are so many of us who love the lakes and love Cumbria, and just love everything about it, including you wonderful people. And I keep on saying that, and you know me by now. I don't say things I don't mean. I always tell you the truth. And when I say we really value your support and your love for the station, we really mean it. Thank you very much indeed. As I said, 15,000 people cannot be wrong. It's absolutely brilliant. So, just to remind everybody once again, your film is at the Roxy in Ulverston on the 8th of December at 4:15.
Correct.
Right. And what have you got to put in to the search engine to find out more about it?
If you put in cumbriabymotorbike.co.uk, you'll find two pages, one about the cinema and also one about viewing it online.
Excellent. Right, there you are. It's Cumbria by Motorbike. If you haven't seen the trailer for it so far, go online and have a look. It is absolutely wonderful. As I said, when I saw the trailer, I was straight on the phone to Kevin. And you were a bit surprised, weren't you?
I was, actually. Yeah.
Yeah. And I thought to myself, we've got to get this guy into the studio.
Thank you.
You're also available on Facebook.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So go to his Facebook page and have a look on there. Like it and share it and do the same with our Facebook page as well, folks. Okay, Lake District Radio, don't forget, your number one go-to station in the lakes, and you will find absolutely fascinating things on both of those Facebook pages and on Kevin's website as well. I can't thank you enough for being a guest in the studio this afternoon. It's absolutely fascinating. Now, you've brought in three copies of books.
Yes.
Right, now then, do you feel a competition coming on?
Yes, that was the reason for bringing them. You read my mind.
Yeah, absolutely.
But absolutely, yeah.
Right, absolutely. We've got three books. The one I mentioned before, Touring Rajasthan by Motorbike, Cumbria and the Lake District by Motorbike, and Northumberland and Hadrian's Wall. And yeah, absolutely. They look really well produced.
All done by me, by myself, on my own.
Right. That was going to be my next question.
The only thing I haven't done is print them.
Right. Yeah. Well, fair enough. Yeah. So all your own work.
Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Right. Okay. Just before you go off off mic, I'll have a little chat to you about sort of what we can do as a giveaway and or a competition, I should say.
Yeah.
And we'll sort that out. Kevin, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for coming in. I'd like to actually invite you back next year.
Right.
If you'd
absolutely.
Like to come.
Absolutely.
When you've been back to India and then come back again.
Come and
tell us about that.
Come now, and tell you a little bit about.
Yeah. Well, you can tell us as much as you want actually. Yeah. I don't think you're going to run out of things to say, to be honest with you. Because we've only just scratched the surface this afternoon.
We haven't even done that today.
Right. Yeah. Now, according to the notes here, Kevin's next film on India, which he's going to he's going over there in January, is provisionally titled Tees, Tigers and Temples. And you say the temples blow your mind.
They're unbelievable. Mm. Absolutely off the scale. A lot of them are run down.
Yes.
A lot of India is run down.
Yes.
But they're magical.
Mm.
Totally and utterly magical. Just the way that they've been built, how long it's taken them to be built, the reason behind why they've been built, the forts are the same as well, because Rajasthan was five kingdoms, so they each had the king, and they all fought between each other and all the rest of the stuff. There's stories about that.
Yeah.
But the temples over there, again, if you went to India, or you're thinking about going to India, my recommendation would be just go, because it will change your life forever. It really will.
Fair enough. And tigers, you ought to see one in the wild if you can, don't you?
Yes. It's something which, there's a couple of animals in this world that I absolutely love. One is the tiger, the other one is the orca, the killer whale.
Yeah,
I love both of those. I'd love to see them in the wild.
Yeah.
I'm going to get an opportunity at Ranthambore National Park, which is near Jaipur in the centre of India.
Right.
Where that is a tiger sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
As you can probably gather, there's no guarantee.
No.
They don't just keep them in a cage and lead them out and say, there's the people, look, take photographs.
Yeah.
It is a case of hit and miss.
But yes.
I'm hoping, and by being over there for 3 months, I can go more than once.
Yeah.
It isn't the cheapest thing to do by any stretch of the imagination. No. But to see one in the wild would just be phenomenal.
Mm. And the third part of that provision is titled Tea. You want to tell the story of tea if you can, don't you?
The drink of the gods.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Is masala chai.
Right.
You can actually get little boxes of this in the co-op.
of all places.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a company called Tea India from down in Dorset. I've just recently found, and I'm not affiliated to them. They don't give me free stuff or anything
like
that.
Oh, right, okay.
But they have a box called masala chai.
Right.
But when I first went over there, they were giving me this tea.
Yeah.
Oh, I just couldn't. I cannot stop drinking it. It's black tea, it's got cardamom in, it's got pepper in, it's got a couple of other little spices in there as well. And so, even though it's a blend, masala chai, when I went up into Assam in the March of 16, we went through the tea plantations.
Right.
We didn't have time to stop because we were going to get to where we're stopping that night. But I'd like to get back into there and see a tea plantation. And just, I know other people have done the story of tea, they've been in and they've seen it. On the TV.
Yeah.
But I haven't done it, and I haven't told people, and I haven't seen it.
No,
so that's
exactly.
What it's all about.
And you want to see it and do it and tell the story in your own way.
Well, I've got a film on YouTube about a little salt. Well, it's the Sambar salt flats.
Yeah.
Again in Rajasthan. And there's a little area, a little factory that produces the salt from the salt flats. And we were just walking around and filming, and no, you can't do that. Anyhow, we spoke to them. He took us inside.
Yeah.
You would not believe how they produce salt compared to how the health and safety would be in this country. Mm. It's back to the days when we didn't have it, and they just throw it in one end, comes out the other, and they're all happy, and you think, get in, that's what life's all about.
Oh, that's brilliant. Well, I tell you what, when I finish the show this afternoon, I'm going to go and have a look at that. I really am. I'm also going to go to the co-op tomorrow.
Yeah, seriously. In the
masala chai.
It's I think it's 40 tea bags.
Right. Okay.
It's £2.60, so it's not the cheapest tea in the world.
No, but then again,
it will just your taste buds will explode.
It's a specialist blend.
Yes, it is.
And it's a quality tea,
yes,
so you expect to pay a bit more, and you can pay as much as that or more for quite ordinary tea, actually.
Don't have the cardamom one.
No.
That's rubbish.
Okay,
but
all right.
The masala chai is just, yeah, tremendous.
Right, and is it? Do you take it black or...?
You can have it really how you would like.
Oh, right, okay.
I use put milk in it.
Yes.
You can also do a latte, which says to boil the milk or simmer the milk and put a tea bag in for about 5 minutes.
Oh, right.
And the flavours then just absolutely explode. But, yeah, you can just use it like a normal tea bag.
Right.
But even my sister who has been, no. Just the last couple of weeks I managed to get her to taste this tea after 3 years.
Yeah.
And she, ooh, that is nice, isn't it?
Ooh, yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, oh, that's brilliant. Kevin, thank you once again. It's
My
been
pleasure.
A great pleasure.
My
Thanks
pleasure.
Very much indeed. That was Kevin Lear, and this is the Carry On Suite.